where the guys had gotten them off. I just sat here realizing that was was you who did that. So it's because of you that I liked her in the first place. So I've never seen that as like an 8-year-old kid, which is not watching Maniac 8 years old. And I remember it was just so shocking when you see the fall and all of a sudden they cut these kids. I mean, it was in some respects more horrific than the Skeeter effects, but this guy comes up with the sorry, I said this, I just realized that I put two and two together right now. So thank you for being able to help. Happy to check for your story.
Is that the one with the intended?
Yeah.
Right, that was the scary movie.
And Paul's in it.
Should I give it to him first?
First one.
Okay. Quick question for Dan. I loved Mother's Day. I think the kettle in the air sequence is probably one of my most favorite things. So as an extension of that, with the score films, were there any concepts that you really wanted to, you know, traps that you just couldn't achieve?
Yeah, so this is horrible, I forget which one's which. Like, they all come together, you film them literally back to back to back. But the lead of the Saw 4, we shot, no, we saw 3 years before I tried to get in. We shot one trap that was a guy in a glass coffin, and it was shards of glass in the glass coffin. He had a ton of body over taking the glass, but he had no room, so no matter how he moved, he cut himself. And he eventually drowned in his own blood. We filmed it, and then they said, you can't put this in a movie. So there was that one. The thing with what Saw, which made it interesting for me, is with the production design, we had a rule that every trap actually had to work. We would not do anything that really wouldn't work without showing it. So there were some ideas we had that were grandiose or cool ideas, but they didn't work. Like, you couldn't, and they would not act as if they really did in the movie. So we did Mythbusters on every trap. We literally set the trap up and say, would this really do what we're showing it to do? And there were some traps that were so, like there was one trap where a guy was twisted, and it was just continually twisting. We put a stunt guy in to check the safety before I went to set, and we had to stop for like, I think it was 2 days, and fix the motors because the actual torque on it was so great, it was actually turning the stunt people's arms around the motor. So, you know, there were a lot of things we had to throw out because we couldn't do them. They just didn't work. But the one with the glass coffin, I think, was a cool visual one. We shot the entire thing, and there's part of it you can see on the lead scene part of it. But that was a problem.
And we stopped tonight, and it was a British time, and had to pass several five disciplines or something. Is it the same for you? Is it one of the ones that you've managed to do?
No, we don't have to go through the same process as the British side. You know, I got started, you know, finding a mentor and learning again and learning from my older and stuff like that. I remember, I don't have a fear of heights, but I didn't like doing high falls, so I don't like doing skydiving. I do think I make myself jump out of a plane. Yeah. So, but some people aspire, some people, you know, are afraid of crashing cars. But for me, it was that making myself do that unnatural thing. I think there's two fears you're born with. One is falling, the other is loud noises.
I got a nice short story. I just got back from Grand Canyon. My dad and I did this Grand Canyon yacht trip. Basically, we started on one end and got to the other end of the rapids. But they do these hikes, and they basically, these hikes, you have to go up steep inclines. But there's one hike you would assign the release to go on. And the reason why is every year, around 2 to 6 tourists die. They fall off. So you have to sign a release before they let you go on this hike. So I go up, I'm like, I'm a badass, I can do this. But I get to the top, I've never seen a grown man cry all of me falling when I got to the top. Because I'm a big dude, I'm a fat guy. And so I get up there, and there's a boulder that sticks out, and you have basically 3 inch ledge to put your foot on. You have to grab the boulder and maneuver yourself around, and it's a 300 foot drop. So it literally, everyone else was doing it in like 30 seconds. I literally took me like an hour side of the other, and I was like sweating, I was freaking out, because I was looking down and seeing a 300 foot drop. So I do it, I finally get through, I saw the control things, I think one up. And when I get out of the Grand Canyon, they're selling a book called Death at the Grand Canyon. And the book is every document of death that's taking place in the Grand Canyon from 1900 to today. And every year, 5 or 6 people die at that exact moment for that exact spot. It's a kind of fear of fall. I was
probably
woman is standing, that still makes the hair on the back of your neck stand. But anything in the exorcist is
welcome. Anyone here see Last House on the Left? The original? It's a horrific film, but there's one moment in it that is particularly horrific. They just get through basically raping and it really screwing with this woman. And there's nothing violent about the scene. It's these three characters, four characters standing up, picking the blood and the grass off of their fingers. And there's a moment where they're all disgusted by what they've just done. And Wes Craven, the clones on them, like 10, 15 seconds each. And there's a moment of regret. And I remember as a kid watching that. And they were trying for a brief second to bring humanity to these horrible monsters. And all of a sudden, something extremely scary, which I brought into Mother's Day, which is the characters, to me, the scariest ones, but still have some humanity left. They're just choosing to do horrible things anyway. So that moment in Last House of the Left Wing was pretty great.
One movie that I remember is one of the scary stories I really like was Dr. Fowles for some reason in this film. I think it was a lot of it was kind of campy, right? I mean, it was humor, didn't it? But for some reason, you just see all those little tracks and things. But just kind of frightening to me.
The Exorcist was the time originally going up in Catholic school and watching that. But one that a lot of people don't think of that really stuck with me was Jaws. And seeing Jaws in the theater and affected me my whole life being afraid of sharks and stuff. And I remember doing that with these stunts up in the open ocean and bobbing around out there and bringing the ear to the But you know, a lot of people think it was a horror movie, but you know, Jaws made a great monster.
It was amazing. Skipping over.
It's a question for Ken. So, how did you sort of approach the role of Jason in his own Ken role and actually own the role of so long? Did you have any fears or apprehensions about that?
I had worked on number 8, Jason Takes Manhattan, as the stunt coordinator, and the stunt double before came, and also the fly clip. And when I had my first meeting for Freddy vs. Jason, which would be the stunt coordinator on the film, the producer was looking at the plan, and I said, you know, we've been interviewing all these people, already from dancers to you know, stunt people and actors. You know, because we want a specific look, this build, and he goes, would you mind meeting one of you? And so before they, I said, of course, and then they said, would you mind auditioning first, putting something on tape? So they did a close-up of my eyes and read the open scene where I was swimming in the lake, and then they had me walk around the room. So after that, I went and had a chance to get the tape and I went with him. And his English wasn't great, so communication wasn't all there, but you know, he really wanted to create a very specific movement for Jason that wasn't like any of the other Jasons. And so we worked on that. Essentially what it was, you know, I just moved very, very, very slowly until I did something that would, you know, highlight, you know, the kill or whatever I did. And so, you know, I didn't have any trepidation going in and doing it because being a stuntman is all about movement. You study an actor, you double, make sure you move like him, and you know, fight scenes or all the movement and everything. So it was a natural thing for me to step in. There's a reason they usually have stunt people as Jason. So, you know, I really didn't know how big a deal it was until after we started doing the promotional stuff for the movie. And brought my little radio station, something like that, come outside and be, you know, getting the fans sitting outside and stuff. And they were walking out on the same way. I thought, what if this was number one? What if this hit number one? And it was number one in the box office for the first 2 weeks. So it was, that's when I really discovered that the movie was and got nervous and did it. How was it like the number one? You know, Robert's fantastic. And as a first time I met him was in the making, Terry and I were in his office. He was made that kind of, hey, Jeff, he goes, we'll see each other for the rest of our lives now. We'll have that in those conventions. I didn't know anything about him, but no, he's been fantastic. And we've become really good friends over the years. And all. I think this is probably the fourth or fifth convention we're going together this year. You know, between him and his wife, Nancy, we went to Europe for the promotional work right after the movie. You know, he just sort of took me on. call him, you know, the Vincent Price of our time. Everybody knows him anywhere in the world, and he goes to all of us restaurants and bars.
Like now, you know, this stuff doesn't happen.
Brown Alley, he's got a leg, he's a lot better. And so the stone locking, it also had a, you know, the railing was concrete as well. And so I, you know, we went up and I showed the applications and JJ showed up. I said, what are you doing? JJ said, trust me. You don't want to kill myself on yourself. So Brad did it, and Brad was clearing well over 15 feet on the run. But by the time he went through the glass, I saw him. He just cleared the railing and literally raised his back on it. And I just thought, I'm glad I turned it on. That's the only one I had actually run away to.
I thought of an answer for you. I got a call from Willimax over in the Einstein's office, and they said, we would like you to do it. Show them the poem. And I said, what? Show them the poem 7? And they said, yeah, show them the poem 7. I turned it down, which was stupid because I could have just done that and then been on their list of directors that they could use. But I never got another call again, you know. So I turned down and showed them the poem 7.
Microphones. And then we had to test the screen to make sure it worked. And then we had to do an hour Q&A for the movie. And we did the movie. And during the movie, we used to get hammered. Like, I would just do shots because I couldn't see anymore. Because it's monotonous, because you're doing it every single time. But I think part of being an artist is fighting for your art. And so if someone says, we don't like that movie, it's relegated to DVD. As an artist, you're only relegated by your own laziness. So I can say, okay, great, it's going to go straight to DVD. Or I can say, screw you, I will take this on the road, I will pay for theaters to show it, I will give it a band for $13. And that's what we did. That was the way that we had to get our own scene. We had to get in a band and go out $13. But we did.
Well, yeah.
Thank you. And so we ended up doing, with Repo, although it does horrible, we did 70 cities. And now with this new movie, we're doing like 90 cities. You got to think about that. We're in 6 cities a night, one day off. So I'll be on the road for 100 plus days just doing this. But that said, it's rewarding because, in fact, I don't need a studio to tell me if my movie is viewable in my audience. I don't need a group of people in big businessmen in suits saying this movie should not be seen. I am that person. I get to be the one to call the theater, put the merchandising out, straight through it. So that way, it's the most freeing thing in the entire world.
And yeah,
if
people really get lots of you about when you're going to turn the money down and stuff like that.
Now, in my position, I don't get an opportunity to turn stuff down too often. There's a little team of things. Everything's relative in the scheme of things. And little films, you know, maybe a little bit of a question for this neighborhood film companies closing. So I'm going to turn it down. But in general, you know, it's a tough business.
Michael Booker, was in an insane, crazy, disturbing movie about a real life serial killer. The second movie I saw was Camp the Holocaust, which that movie just makes me vomit even now. My brother's really like 7, 8. Yeah. And again, it doesn't have to see it. I mean, you might just go to the bathroom and go, oh, man. The third movie, ironically, was Children of the Corn, the original Children of the Corn. That's one of those movies that Children of the Corn I love because kids freak me out. Kids scare me. I finally had my first child, a 6 months old, and terrorized me for a different reason than Children of the Corn. But I love that movie, and there was a moment in my career, long ago, that I was also dealing with dementia. They wanted to reboot three movies. They wanted to reboot Scanners, Children of the Corn, and Hellraiser. And at that moment, they were like, you have to do one of these movies. You have to. I had to deal with it, but I didn't do one of them. I would have loved to be Children of the Corn. We just couldn't figure out a way into it. Back in the day, it made sense because people didn't have cell phones, they didn't have Twitter or Instagram or whatever. How do you isolate a town completely that doesn't have that technology? So an entire town could basically be murdered off and no one know about it. So I couldn't wrap my head around that, but that says that. But to answer your question, if I could give you any meat whatsoever, I could give you anything, flowers in the eye. I know they just created a lifetime, but that book as a child was the most horrific, scary, terrifying book. And it's a true monster movie. It's a monster movie, the fact of the parent, her mother, being a monster, who's not a monster. They made an adaptation in the 80s with Christy Swanson and Darren, what else was saying. I wouldn't do that. I would make you much more hardcore, in-your-face monster movie without a monster. So, my opinion would be flowers in the other.
Mm-hmm. So, to wrap up with just a favorite movie as a kid or a movie that left a lasting impression for each one.
Jason and the Argonauts.
Killer Clowns from Outer Space.
That's all.
Man with Two Faces.
Ah, really? Very influential. Yeah, of course. Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to put your hands again for our
Yeah.